So I think we're going to do almost everybody.
Here's our agenda. This is what we're going to talk about today. So we'll do some introductions real quick. We'll talk about the membership vision and goals. And we'll talk about our three key areas. I used an acronym, RPM, which stands for Reengage, Promote, Pack Growth, and Maintain Your Memberships. So these are kind of three key things you're going to want to do when you're recruiting your scouts. We'll have recruiting tips and tools, questions, comments, final thoughts. So who am I? I am Heather Cooper-Krossman. I am the membership chair for Sunset Trail District. I'm also the secretary and membership chair for PAC 685.
Yay!
All my contact information, that's all in the CD, or I have cards if you want a card. So I really want to know who comes, so if you can just, maybe we'll just go around the room, just quick name, what pack you're from, what your position is, and just one thing that you're hoping to get out of class. You can just share.
I'm David Hammond. I'm from PAC 122 in Beaverton, Sunset District. I just found out last week I am going to be the committee chair. I'm also an assistant band leader, so I just registered as a regular band leader. I'm an assistant treasurer. I'm whatever people need, and right now I'm the informal recruiter.
Okay.
And would love to find someone to formally do it.
Tell me about it.
I'm passionate about
okay.
Getting more people involved in, you know, many hands light work. One thing I hope to look at how to be more effective for recruitment, how to get more boys, and frankly, how do we get more engaged families?
Yes.
Not just more boys, but it's really the engaged families that are critical.
I'm Therese, I'm from PAC 690. I'm the active assistant band leader and the recruiter.
I'm Kent Bridge, PAC 424 in Camas. I am the co-master in training. And I just want to be learn more about recruiting for next year.
Benjamin Venable, Thunder River District PAC 4. I'm the Wolf Band leader. And we're struggling in our pack with retention.
Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about that.
So my name is Matt Bledsoe. I'm PAC 321 down in Albany. I'm the Cub Master and how to be more effective in recruiting. What are maybe some better ways where we're, you know, spending our energy more efficiently?
I'm Brian Drew. I'm from PAC 200. I'm Cub Master. And definitely need to find some ways where our new scouts kind of dropped off over the last couple of years.
Okay.
So need some new scouts.
Neil Rewer, PAC, newly forming PAC 544.
Yes. Love you.
Cub Master, recruiting techniques. I have some, but I'd like to see what else is out there to better utilize recruitment.
Hi, my name is Jenny Byrne. I am from PAC 664. I am the Cub Master. I'm also the Cub Scout Roundtable Commissioner for Thunderbird District. And what is one thing I hope to take away? Just some ideas. We have some struggling PACs, and I get tapped often to help them. So just going to see if anybody has an idea that hasn't come to me yet.
Okay. Great.
Henry Kahn, PAC 163 out of Vancouver. I'm a den leader and part of the Key 3, and we have a rough year this year, whereas other PACs have grown 20% in some cases. We didn't have any Tigers come to our recruitment night this year, so I'm looking for ways to reach out.
I'm Crystal Nair. I'm the district executive for Fort Clatsop, all the way up that way. I'm also the Tiger Den leader and the advancement chair for PAC 509. I'm looking for the best way to nurture recruiting in the other people in our area, the units that we already have in our district.
Right.
509 has systematically, not on purpose, but they've sucked all the good parent involvement families out of the other units because they put on a fabulous scouting program, and we really need to get everybody up to scale, or they're all going to end up in one unit.
Yeah.
We have that same problem.
Yeah.
Amazing the number of transfers this year.
We just finally said no more.
Yeah. So that's actually also something we'll talk about because council doesn't really love when you borrow other campuses. Mm-hmm. So.
My name is Erica. I'm from PAC 516 in Vancouver. Coincidentally, it is the same PAC that my tiger is in that my oldest son, who just eagled in June, came out of. Mm-hmm. And looking at how my oldest son, how the PAC was so big when he was there, and how small it is now, and how do you go back about getting that PAC built back up?
You're just a fly on the wall.
I'm not here.
Okay. You're eating lunch. All right, well, welcome, and I really appreciate everybody coming, and I hope that you will be able to take away exactly what it is that you need. And if not, you have my information, and you can come look for me. Okay, so we're going to start with membership. Membership vision. This is something that we came up with for Sunset Trail District, but I think it's pretty applicable to pretty much any place that you are. The whole vision is to build and increase the membership within scouting by providing new units, so like you're doing your building. And we're going to provide you with easy to follow plan tools to help you promote that scout growth. Re-engage, the ones that are dropped off, we're taking them back, and maintain what you have. So what are our membership goals? Most people have pretty much the same growth, and that growth is going to be within scouting as a whole. We want to see scouting from Cubs to Boy Scouts to Venture, all of it, just we want to see the whole program grow. So everybody's working together to try to get scouting back, the numbers back up. Growth within individual units, so within your packs, working on that. And then creating new packs. Retention, obviously, keeping your current scouts, and not just keeping them, but keeping them active and participating. Because if they're just hanging out, they're kind of on that cusp of maybe not being there anymore. And then a big one is crossing over into Boy Scout troops. A lot of our Cubs don't cross over, or they cross over and they drop out really quickly because maybe they didn't research what troop is good for them, and they just quit instead of keeping, you know, look for something else. So that crossover is a really big problem for scouting retention as a whole. So we got the goals. How are we going to, this is where the RPM comes in. So we came up with this because it's easy to remember, and it's really the building blocks of doing successful recruiting at club level. Re-engage. So that's getting those old scouts that dropped off and they're not coming anymore, or that are kind of on the border of doing that. Promoting, so you get new scouts, recruiting events, things like that, and maintaining what you have. So pretty simple stuff. So we'll talk about re-engaging first. You guys are all seeing this in your packs. Scouting membership in general, especially in council, it's down overall. I think every council is kind of experiencing it. It's a little bit of a roller coaster. The numbers go up and down, but it tends to be a little bit down. We're CPC is actually having growth this year, so we're really excited about that. But in general, scouting's not as popular as it used to be. So what happened? We've got scouts that have left PACs, scouts that didn't cross over, and scouts dropped out of the level. So we should talk about really those problems. So re-engaging. It's about finding the scouts that have left your PAC, because sometimes you got to track them down, and inviting them to come back. And inviting is the key. Why do you want to do that? It's an easy way to grow your PAC. Some of the reasons your scouts leave, they may have had barriers. We've had scouts that have had family emergencies, transportation issues, family issues, sports. Sports is a huge one. You have boys that are like, oh, I've got soccer now. And then they leave to do soccer, and then you don't see them again. So a lot of barriers are temporary. And when they left, maybe those barriers aren't there anymore, but they just never got around to coming back. Plus, it might be easier to re-engage your former scouts than to recruit new ones, because they already know the program, your parents know the leadership, and some of those boys may still have friends that are in the pack. That peer-to-peer recruiting is really big. Hey, we're still having a really good time at Cub Scouts. Why don't you come back? We really missed you. So finding out where those scouts are, look at your roster for the last 2 years. That's what we suggest is 2 years. If you go back a little bit farther than that, it's a little bit hard to find them, but 2 years is a pretty good
unit of measure there, and go through it and see who's left. If you don't have a roster that you track, you should. I think everybody does. And then also look at your past leads. So anyone who came to a recruitment event or sent an inquiry through Be a Scout. Is everybody on Be a Scout?
Mm-hmm.
Be a Scout is huge, because those people that send you a request through Be a Scout, you didn't have to lift a finger. They came looking for you. So they're almost recruiting you, and if you don't get back to them, that's a, I mean, that's low-hanging fruit you didn't even pick. So going through those past leads, we keep attendance rosters for all of the boys who stop by our recruitment events, and we just go back through and check and say, hey, what's going on? So obviously you're gonna need some tools for that, re-engaging. So recruitment events. We do our recruitment events at the school that we are chartered with, and that's primarily where we do most of our stuff. We set up a tent. We're out in the field, we see all of the boys, we see all of the parents, and we make a point to say, hey, how's it going, to a former scout and their parent. Make sure they know we're still here. Hey, we've missed you, we'd love to have you back. Here's what we're doing next week, here's a join night information.
Make a point that when you talk about recruitment event, you're talking about not a join night, you're talking about a point where you can make a connection with your potential audience.
Right, so we go to like open house.
Right.
Open house night, book fairs, things like that. And then make sure that you have an event that you want to invite those parents to. Den meetings and pack meetings are a little bit wishy-washy. Pack meetings are kind of a mess. They're chaotic in nature. And den meetings is not always a great representation of what we're doing as a pack. But having that specific event rather than saying, I'd love to see you sometime. You can do an email, a mailing, or a call night. Send them out, post a call night. The big one with this is that mass emails don't work because they're impersonal. No one wants to get a Dear Scout parent, we really miss you email, because this scout parent is going to say, no, you don't. You didn't even remember my name. So if you're going to do it, make sure you at least cut and paste and put a name in there. Try to touch base at least once with your scouts that have left. It's sometimes hard. If you call, leave a couple messages, you're not getting anything, move on. But yeah, make it personal, because if you don't let them know that they're important, they're going to think they're not, and they are, because they're ways to cover up. Utilize your current scouts. So it's that peer-to-peer recruiting. Have them invite their scout, former scout friends back to the pack. There is what's called buddy cards that you can find in the brand center. You can personalize them. You can put your scout's name on them and information about join nights and things like that. And they can hand them out to their friends, and they can get recruiter strips. And you can incentivize your scouts to help bring their friends back. You know, and kids are having fun in scouting as long as they go, hey, everything's great. It works very well. Your district and your council have tools, obviously, via Scout. Key with that is make sure your PIN is active. So you said you're all on it. Make sure your PIN is active and that you have detailed information on your PIN, not just where, pack, whatever. Where you're meeting, your times, things like that. And have your registration option open, activated, so that they can register online. It makes it really easy. And then reach out to those scouts that didn't join your pack if you got leads before, and follow up on leads you didn't make contact with, and you can always check with your district council or membership committee for help if you run into stumbling blocks. Maybe you've got a scout you really think will come back if you just get a hold of the parent, and you're having trouble. Get a hold of somebody else, membership at your district. Maybe they'll be willing to put a call in for you, sometimes a different name, a different voice, will get some attention. So, the most important part about this is that personal contact and follow-up are the crucial parts to re-engaging your scouts. I took a class, and that number two was the key point. A lack of follow-up conveys the message that you don't care. And it's really true. If you've got a bunch of kids that come up to your tent at an open house and
they just scatter to the wind and you never go looking for them, or you have scouts that have dropped off and you haven't even called. You have a den leader that your scout hasn't come for 6 months, didn't even bother to tell anybody, hasn't made contact with parents. As a parent, I'm thinking, they don't care, they didn't even notice that I left. So it's a, not a good message we want to send. Any questions about re-engaging? And I know this is a lot of information. Like I said, all of this is on this, the CD, so don't feel like you have to furiously take notes or anything. Okay, so on to promote. Promote pack growth. Pack promotion equals pack growth. Simple math. The more you get out there and you promote your pack, the more likely you are that your pack is going to get new scouts. Things you want to consider about growth, though, know where you draw your scouts from, where you get the bulk of your scouts. If you don't know, your district committee has that information. You can get a hold of them and they'll give you a report that'll show you where each one of your scouts is coming from. Most of us tend to, that would be helpful for you to pull that report. Most of us tend to come from one or two schools or churches or places like that, but know where you're getting your scouts from. Have a way that your scouts are going to be able to find you. So how can they find you? Do you have yard signs out? Do you have a banner at the fence at school? Do you have, be a scout, you know, you're active so that they can find you. Have ways that they can find you. If you've never recruited before, where do you start? And what tools are there available to help you? And then you're gonna wanna set your goals. You wanna know how many you think you want to recruit and how many you can think you can accommodate. Because those are two really different things. You can say, I'm gonna get 40 scouts this year, but you need in a closet. That's not going to happen. So you keep those numbers kind of balanced between what you want and what you actually feel like you can accommodate. Or maybe your leadership can't accommodate that many scouts. So keeping those things in mind. And approaching it kind of like a weight loss strategy. Have that long-term goal, but have some short-term goals that you can also go along. Because it gets really frustrating if you're just looking at getting 40 new scouts. You know, make a goal to say, I'm gonna get, I wanna recruit 5 new tigers at spring recruitment. Or we need to rebuild the wolf den. Because we have one of those. Make some short-term goals because then you're getting somewhere and you're still growing and it's that sense of accomplishment. So promoting pack growth, it's about building membership by identifying where you can draw your scouts from, holding successful recruitment events, and using the tools that work for you. Work for you is the key. I'm going to give you all kinds of tools. It might not be what works for you. You might love them. You might hate them. You might go on Pinterest and find other things to do. But find what works for you and then stick with it. Or when it doesn't work, feel free to change it up because there's no right or wrong answer. So where are we going to find, where are we going to recruit our scouts from? Look through your pack roster. Find where you're getting current ones from. Network with people in your location. That doesn't necessarily mean it has to be the school, the church, the organization that you typically get your scouts from. Canvas your neighborhood. And network with people that are in your neighborhood. Easy ones are younger siblings of your current scouts. So keep an eye on those and make sure that you're getting them ready to come up as they come up in the age. And then again, tools, there's all kinds of tools. There's council tools, district tools, national tools, local tools, tools galore. Stay in your lane. So this is what I was talking about with you. Focus on recruiting at your current location. Doesn't matter where that is. School, a church, neighborhood, whatever. And go deeper in that location. So rather than saying, all of my leads are dried up at my school, so I'm gonna go over to this school and get some more kids. Maybe your leads are not dried up here. Look for other things that you can do. Because you end up with like your situation where you're gonna be drawing kids from other schools. Now that school may have a really dwindling pack because you're pulling those kids, or maybe they want to start a pack and they can't now because they don't have enough. And in the meanwhile, you have 150 scouts that you can't manage. So deepen that recruiting and stay there and just go deep. So talking to coaches, after school program staff,
They're great for leagues. Coaches, you know, meet with boys and have, you know, 10, 12 boys and parents held hostage for games and practices all the time. And those people talk, those parents talk when they're in watching games. So you talk to a coach, hey, are you willing to mention Cub Scouts to your boys? We can work around your schedule, I think it'd be great. And again, moms are king. Find those moms that talk to each other. You get mom bloggers. That word of mouth is huge. And then get to know the VIP at your location. So assuming your principal, your minister, your staff, they're the gatekeepers. We actually had this happen to us where we had an incident that didn't go very well, and we were left out of the school. And once you get to where someone says, you're not recruiting here, you're out in the cold. So work with those VIPs, because they're the ones who are going to provide you with those opportunities to recruit or cut off your recruiting options. Take a coffee, whatever. So tools. District and council tools. So district council, they have customized posters and yard signs and stickers and all kinds of stuff that you can get for free. I have some examples over here if you want to take, look, whatever. They're really easy to get. You just put in an order, depending on how busy they are. You know, it usually takes like 2 weeks max, and they'll give you as many as you want for free. They're considered to be soft marketing tools, and I was on a webinar that talked about soft marketing, and they said that 67% of scouts join from one soft marketing contact. So that's huge. That means 67% of the scouts in your pack most likely joined because they saw a flyer, they saw a yard sign, somebody said something to them. It's a pretty big percentage. So those things work. So make an effort to put that out there. And then those peer-to-peer buddy cards, again, with the boys. Be a scout, I'll keep harping on be a scout because it really works well. As long as you got the information and you get back to those responses right away. My suggestion is have one committee member, one leader, somebody who's in charge of doing that response that can get on it quickly. And that way you don't have 8 people responding to some poor person that wants to know about Cub Scouts, but you know it's going to be taken care of. Be visible. This has been, you know, just be out in your community. Set up a recruiting table or booth at back to school nights or book fairs. Have a table, put your scouts in uniform, have your leaders in uniform. I'll show you a picture of what ours looks like. We have a photo board, some derby cars, things like that to get the boys drawn to the table and interested. And then make sure you get the names and contact information of every family that stops by your booth so that you can follow up and say, hey, I handed you a flyer for our join night. I was just checking to make sure you were in town. You can also have a uniform day for the boys. We're doing that this year. We've never done it before, but we're going to send the boys in their uniform on packing days. The boys, when they have all the decoration, I mean, the other boys go, wow, where did you get that? And it works really well. So that's what our recruiting tent looks like. So we set up a tent in the field adjacent to where they serve the ice cream bars. And we have a banner that goes across our table. We've got some rockets, some derby cars. We usually throw some handbooks out there too, so the boys can kind of look at what the handbooks look like. We have a photo board with some exciting things that we've done. We have our scout in the uniform, who is maybe not as happy to recruit. He's my son, so but he gets to do it anyway. And you know, our cub master in the uniform. Community participation is another way to get out there. You know, do service projects. We do the Beaverton Parade every year. We hand out information on our join night. We get people all the time. Other events, just, you know, getting out there and do flag ceremony or school assemblies, Veterans Memorial Day, those types of things. Let your neighborhood know that scouting is alive and thriving in the area. I went to a farmer's market and somebody came up to me and said, I didn't know there were still scouts around. Let them know you're around. Okay, so then you go to your join night. Your join nights are huge. you're going to want to plan and execute a successful joint night. So the best way to do that is start by participating in your fall and your spring recruitments and have a joint night for each one. They may not be equally attended, but do your best to do one for each. Plan it close to when you do a recruiting event, like an open house, so there's not too much time for parents to forget, but there's enough time for you guys to get it all together. Offer incentives to your current scouts to bring a friend. And then follow up on those leads or anybody, make sure that you extend that invitation again. Make sure you plan it in advance with your committee so that everybody knows what they're doing. Nothing spells disaster like a joint night where no one knows what they're supposed to do. So deciding who, what, and where, make sure everybody shows up.
Hold on, thank you for wanting us to remember.
Where's some name tags? People know who you are. There's a discussion about whether uniforms are good or not. Some people believe it sets a us versus them thing, and it's not good. We tend to have our cub master and the higher up people in a uniform and our den leaders in pack t-shirts. But yeah, if you get all that together, you'll impress your new parents by how organized your pack is. And then you can always, if you've got a big brother troop, have them come down and help run some of your games. Having those Boy Scouts is a huge help, and it also is great for the new scouts to see, oh, there's Boy Scouts, and that it goes beyond just the study. Yes, we have played with this for years. Have a new parent information meeting at your joint night, but don't put it next to the scout activities. Your parents cannot hear you if they're next to the scout activities. Do something adjacent to where your parents know their scouts are safe, but pull them aside.
So last year we did that, mm-hmm. and we got some really strong, we got really strong feedback that the parents really did not like it because they don't know who all these people are, and they're leaving their kids, and then we're asking them to go, you know, up into the building while the boys are all up front mm-hmm. with strangers.
Yep.
So this year we didn't do it that way. We did two, you know, but yeah.
Yeah.
So
it's up to you how you want to run it. We introduce our leadership before we split the group off. So the parents can see, my boy is going to go with this person. That's their den leader. So that they know, and we try to stay like within the next room, and that way the parents can go check on them, and it's fairly fluid.
I also find it's easier, it's less traumatic for the parents to have the event where the kids are going to be playing, and then bring the parents to a side room so they already know that this environment is safe, and
yes.
their kid's not going anywhere strange.
Exactly.
So moving the parents away from the kids rather than taking the kids away from the parents
exactly.
is less abrasive.
And we try to start everything together if we can. But, you know, sometimes the boys just, they want to go play.
And some parents just stay with their kids and then they come and get us after.
That's, yeah.
It's also another great opportunity to use your Boy Scout troop that you might be affiliated with
mm-hmm.
because it softens it a little bit for the parents if they're, yes, there's other adults there, but there's lots of boys,
right.
older boys.
Yes.
And somehow that makes it safer
yeah.
in their minds.
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
I would think it would be more dangerous because I know the boys, but I'm not telling them.
More importantly, you have that extra help.
It's not out the building that we get abducted.
Right.
So before you start your meeting, we're still playing with this because it's something I really like. It doesn't always work great. But you want to know, ask your parents, why are you here? What do you want to get out of Cub Scouting? Like, I asked each one of you to tell me one thing you wanted to take away from the class. Some of the ideas were similar, but not everybody had the exact same reason for being here. And your parents are going to be the same way. If you can find out why they're here, then you can make sure you address why they're there and get all their questions answered. So make sure you have a presentation ready. Keep it simple. Don't overdo BSA lingo. Very few of your parents are scouts.
Huh? Did you have the collar?
Very few parents are involved in scouting enough that they're going to know what you're talking about, and it's just kind of like, ooh, over their head, and you'll lose them really fast. Address those why are you here questions, and make sure you're talking about the values that scouting provides the boys besides just having fun. Your boys want to race cars, shoot things, and run around and go camping. Your parents want their boys to have fun, but they also want them to be getting something out of it. So that's your parents. You speak to them on that level, speak to the boys on the fun level, and you can meet in the middle. So Tufts University did a study, and I'll show you a really quick clip that we used on our joint night this year, talking about those values and how it impacts. It's a really good minute and a half that just encapsulates exactly what your parents are looking for. And then this is also an opportunity to talk about the whole family scouting experience and how to keep your parents involved, that yes, we need parents, we run on volunteers. And then I heard a Cubcast that said that the scout program is the most reward from the least amount of time. So things like sports and other activities take more time for less value. More than an hour a week. Show a video, slideshow, or photo display board. Pictures are worth 1,000 words. Your millennial parents, which they're really studying how to recruit millennial parents right now, they love videos. They're all over YouTube. They're all over, well, they're shutting down Vine, but they love that stuff. So show them how much fun their sons are going to have in Scouts. And in particular, into your pack, if you can do it, rather than just a stock video. There's the comic. I actually found it like 2 days ago. So here's a really good an example of not using lingo, because I don't understand any of that.
It's all Boy Scout lingo.
I know what an SPL is, yeah.
But when we start talking about CORs.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. It's a lot of words. Any video?
Oh, now? Which one do you want to do? Tufts?
Yeah, Tufts is
okay,
first.
Okay, I got the other one loaded.
Okay.
You got it?
Okay. Okay, so here's the Tufts one that I just talked about. Like I said, it's really quick, but it's fantastic information.
Everyone knows a goal of scouting is to prepare young people to succeed in life. But is it working? What if we can understand just how effective scouting is in shaping young minds?
Thanks to the John Templeton Foundation, the BSA was able to partner with Dr. Richard Lerner and his team from Tufts University to follow nearly 1,800 Cub Scouts for 3 years and compare them to nearly 400 boys of similar backgrounds who are not in Scouts. What they found was remarkable.
Cub Scouts show significant positive development in attributes of being cheerful, helpful, kind, obedient, trustworthy, and hopeful.
But there were no significant increases in these character attributes among non-Scouts. In fact, non-Scouts reported decreased scores for the attribute of religious reverence.
Scouts were also more likely than non-Scouts to choose helping others or doing the right thing over being smart, being the best, or playing sports.
What's more, youth who participated in both sports and scouting were more likely to choose these same values than those who only played sports.
And finally, the study showed that boys who spent more time in scouting had higher positive character attributes.
Scouting builds positive character and provides young people with a foundation they can stand on to embrace opportunity and overcome obstacles.
With fun and discovery at every turn, scouting makes the most of right now. Scouting works.
So that's the Tufts University.
Whoops. Everyone knows
that. So as a parent, if you saw that, that's pretty hard hitting, I think. When they show that little graph and you go, wow.
Oh, it's doing work.
Yeah, just a okay. So for a minute and a half, that's pretty impactful for just a minute and a half.
That's
so,
on YouTube.
Yeah. On YouTube, or the Brand Center also has it, which okay. I've got the link to
which
that.
Which is a QuickTime video?
It is. It's only QuickTime when you download it. I don't know. It's weird. But yes, it is at YouTube. If you go to YouTube and just Google Scouting Works, you'll find it. So. Okay, and then I'm going to show you our Join Night video. This is put together with things that our pack has done.
So can I tell them about how we did this?
Yeah.
Okay. So Heather's told you that that's leader video. So Heather told you about how we split the group off. We had the scouts over here, and Heather and I talked to the adult leaders over here. What we did is, for about 45 minutes, the scouts did fun things, and we talked about scouting and screened the test video. And then we brought them back together. We brought the scouts into the adult room. We had them sit with their parents. We watched the Tufts with
just the parents.
The parents.
So this one we watched with their parents.
This one we screened.
Our pack scouts.
Right. So we brought all the scouts, our scouts and our prospective scouts in, sit down, watch this video. And at the end, I said, does this look like fun?
You said who wants to be a Cub Scout.
And I said, who wants to be a Cub Scout now? Tell your parents.
And they all raised their hand.
Watch how this works.
we were lost at sea, we would look at the bright night sky, thinking of what we could be, or what we could be, how to spend our lives. Remember when we had nothing left? We were strung out in the cold, holding on, trying to save our breath, trying to save our breath. We would not let go. Oh, through the good, through the bad and ugly. Trust in counting stars, we were counting stars, trying to find our way. Remember up on the mountaintop, looking out on the rocks below, thinking, God, will we never stop? We will never stop, no, we won't let go. 'Cause one day we're gonna come back and laugh.
Have some sort of parent guide. Council will give you one. It's kind of generic. If you can do one of your own, that's even better. I got some random. I put some samples of our parent guide in there.
This one's a little bit older.
Yeah, and it's a little bit long and involved, but we've gotten good feedback on it. Also, make sure that you have a calendar. 12 to 18 months is recommended. We do a 12-month calendar. This is what ours looks like. Just do like a little one-pager. Because this is going to show your parents, as they're looking at it, this is everything we're doing for the year. It shows them how active we are. Also shows them what their time commitment is going to be. It leaves them pretty informed. We also put med forms in there, because I don't like chasing down people 2 weeks before camp. And we created a QR code a couple years ago for your parents that don't like paperwork. They can snap it on their phone. It goes directly to our Via Scout online registration link. They can register right there, bring it up to the treasurer. We've got a square now. We can take credit cards, swipe it. They're signed up. They're paid. They get their handbook and their pack t-shirt, and they're out the door. Done. Done deal. If you have to chase them down for an application, it's a little bit time-consuming. Try to get that paid application before they leave.
I was just going to ask you, because I'm looking at your fees. Mm-hmm. So $34, that's your registration fee. Mm-hmm. Covers your t-shirt and obviously covers the little bit extra that you have to put in there for all the people that pay with Square.
Because
I'm fighting my committee chair right now. I want to Square so bad.
It's not that bad. Here's the
answer. Tell me how
I can convince
them.
When we do fall recruitment, the prorate for a scout for the end of the year and boy's life is like $10, I think.
Yeah.
And so we do next year also. So I say you'll register at the end of this year and the end of 2017. So that's another $36 on top of that. It's like $45, $46. Our pack t-shirt, $6. We have a special custom patch for our numbers. It's another $4. That's another $10. $50. It ends up being like $58, $57. I just round it to $60.
So
$60 flat fee. If you pay cash, that extra goes into your scout account.
Okay. Got it.
Yeah.
That's how I can sell it to her.
We found when we register for like other events too, our parents have no problem paying that 1% or whatever it is.
It's 2.75.
Okay. Yeah. We're like, oh, it's an extra, dollars. Oh, no problem. It's convenient.
Yeah. And then you get the funds.
Yeah.
Well, that's what...
On the flip side, we use it for popcorn sales also. Mm-hmm. And I did the math. We sold $4,000 of popcorn. Some of it was on Square.
You just
the
eat it on
Square
popcorn.
Square fees were $14.
Yeah,
total.
I mean,
I'd rather make the sale than not.
I'd rather write the $14 check to make
yes.
it even accounting.
Exactly.
I mean, that's easy.
I can tell you my daughter's Girl Scout troop uses Square for cookie sales, and it makes
clean.
It makes it so much easier.
People don't
wear
cash anymore.
Yep. So,
I'm not
okay.
as familiar with Via Scout as I should be. You're saying that
there's a class.
Families, I'm sure there is. Families can register online.
Yep.
No hard copy.
Correct.
What about leader application?
Not yet.
Those can be online.
They keep saying it's coming, but it's not done yet.
All right.
Has
so
with
all of the scout paperwork. At that site.
Yep.
That's, that is
yep. Yeah, it makes it super easy.
You've got to go into the Via Scout tool and click the, make sure your PIN is active and your online application is active.
Yep.
And your keys will do that.
Yep.
One last question.
Yep.
Someone call out your $34. How do you guys get away with only $34?
No, we're working on that. It's going up a little bit this
Sorry,
year.
Sorry,
we're at 90.
How we get away with $34?
For our fees?
Yeah.
Fundraising.
Do you guys
we do four fundraisers.
Well, if you look,
you don't pay
that's
for
just
activities.
Their registration.
Okay, so you
our
do
scouts.
Every event, every activity. They, okay, so we all right. That's the difference.
Yep,
so
that's,
going
that's
free.
Okay.
Yeah, we don't pay for that. So that's.
But you let them preload their scout account.
They can fundraise for.
You know,
we would let
people preload, but our previous treasurer was kind of against that.
Yeah.
I totally disagree. I'm with you. Preload it with at least $10-$20, so
just,
you can just.
So you always have money.
Come bowling with us, right?
We also usually have at least one fundraiser, if not two, before our first major big buck, event, so that they get that option.
So they have some money in their scout account.
Yeah.
And are they?
Yeah. So as much as you can, get that signed paid application before they walk out.
In the past, we've done that with fundraising. We just changed it to where we actually have a pack dues.
Make sure you introduce your leadership that helps your parents feel better.
So that's due January 1st.
And, you know, again, it's talking to your parents on their level of what they care about. So that tells university study looks great.
Most of our scouts cost roughly $30.
Moms are the decision makers. Dads can say, yeah, I want my kid to do scouts. Mom's the one that writes the check. So keep that in mind when you're talking to your parents, that you're going to focus a lot on what moms want out of it. And those millennials, again, they choose one or two things for their scouts, their kids to do all year long. So you really have to sell it to them to be that one or two thing that they're going to choose. Scouting sells itself to boys that you have to sell to parents. And that's the hard thing. Any more questions on that? It's really hard sometimes for leaders to get out of the mindset of leaders and get back into what did you want when you are a new parent looking to join. And that's where you kind of have to go with that, is what did you want for your boys when you were there, when you were a new parent?
I have one more question.
Yeah.
So, boys joining mid-year, because of course, ideally, we're recruiting 365.
Yep.
Obviously, that has significant implications to a boy who joins in January as far as them advancing.
They'll do their Bobcat.
Yeah.
It depends on your scout and how far into the year it is. We had a scout that joined, it was like 2 or 3, 4 months into the year.
He joined in March,
he was
a tiger.
And he wanted to earn the tiger rank, and so he worked on it at home, made up what was missing, and worked our advancement chair. Worked with the mother to make sure he got it done. And
that's the happy half. What happens when that doesn't happen? Do you just not advance them?
Yeah. No, you advance.
They don't get a patch, but
they will not. Yeah, they will earn their tiger rank.
They didn't actually get a chance to ask in the Cub Scout training.
Yeah.
So
they just won't get their rank.
They just don't get. Okay. And that's actually, we do that.
Yeah.
Say, I'm sorry, you didn't earn it.
Yeah.
Yes, we do.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I want to say real quick, when we've had scouts that come in mid-year like that, instead of saying, well, here's the stuff you missed, we say, all right. Here's the stuff that's required. Here's the stuff we're planning to do before the end of this year. Here's the stuff that your scout's going to do, and really lay it out for them step by step and make it easy, because nobody looks in the book.
Yes, true. No kidding. Yeah.
Nobody looks in the book. So.
Okay, last part of RPM. We're talking about maintaining and motivating your scouts. So this is going to make sure that you keep those scouts that you have. We don't want them dropping off. Your scouts need to stay engaged, having fun, and learning, or they will walk right out the door. So motivating is how you're going to keep those scouts interested and engaged in your pack, and that's going to keep them around for the long term. So, yep, keeping scouts you have, motivating them to stay. So finding those opportunities. Make sure you're taking attendance. At every PAC meeting, at every PAC event, at every DEN meeting, taking attendance. Attendance is the best way for you to find out where those danger zones are, where those cracks are that you may have scouts that are starting to get disengaged. Just pay attention and look around. Do you have scouts that are struggling to pay for events? Do you have families that are not getting there? Maybe there's a way that you can reach out and offer help with those things. Scouts that are bored, telling you they're bored. We had scouts that said, we don't want to do archery again. It's all right, we'll take it off the table. So look for those types of things and make sure that you create your leadership as a solid foundation, because the more your leaders work well together and share information, the easier it'll be that you can catch those scouts. Motivating. Make sure you're doing annual planning and make sure that you're having parent meetings and committee meetings. We have once a month parent meetings. Our parents don't typically tend to come, but I encourage them to come. I say, hey, if you want to say in what your scout is doing, how this pack is running, come to the pack meeting. And then build that awesome calendar. Be active. Make sure you're getting out and do things. Try some new stuff. And also, if you can, have some things over the summer. We do one activity a month over the summer, two activities a month over the summer. Our boys are in the Summertime Activity Board. It keeps them in that routine of scouts all year long, so you don't have to worry about them dropping off over the summer and getting them back in the fall.
A monthly parent committee, so that is that, is that the same as the leaders meeting? You just add all the parents, you have
our,
like your whole pack, or?
Our committee meets, we call it a parent planning meeting. It's our committee, it's our DEN leaders, it's parents, anybody who wants to come and have input on what we're doing.
and we throw it all together.
So you don't have a separate leadership meeting, it's just you invite the parents to come to the leadership meeting.
Yep, that's right.
That's where you get to serve the Kool-Aid.
That's right.
And they call it a parent meeting because then that helps them know that they're not walking into a leader meeting. We call it a parent meeting, they feel more welcome.
We do it in two chunks. We invite the parents to come to the leader meeting, and the first half of it is things that everybody wants to know, and then we go, okay, now we're gonna go on to the business side. We'd love for you to stay, we'd love your input. But if you don't want to stay for that, you're good to go.
Yeah.
So they have an out, and then if they stay, we rope them into more things.
Yeah.
I've only got an hour.
And if your parents, and if your parents are giving you feedback, whether it's at a meeting, when they pull you aside, or anything like that, listen to what they're saying. Because if you know, they know their kids better than anybody else, so they're going to give you feedback and make sure that you listen to what they're saying.
And just a quick question: where do you guys have your planning meetings, parent meetings? Do you
have
the same place that you meet for your, and do you do it on a separate night or the same night?
Every Tuesday.
So I just talked to a lot of PACs that and as a troop, as a younger man, our troop did it on a Thursday, we met on Mondays. And Ben, was it you or somebody else said, we meet on Sundays
to do our planning. We have our den meetings and PAC meetings on Tuesdays,
right.
And then second Friday is the committee meeting.
Is that in the same location?
Same exactly.
And the kicker here is that the way we do it is first and third weeks are den meetings, second is parent planning committee meeting, and fourth is PAC meeting. And so I'm stealing a meeting from my den leaders.
Yeah.
And their hair is that much more on fire
trying
to get the requirements done. And I hate doing that, but it's kind of what I walked into.
It works for us,
it
put it that way.
Mostly.
Well,
and it gets them in the habit of every Tuesday at 7 o'clock is scouts.
Yeah.
Well, and it makes it easy for parents because in order to be a leader, they don't have to give up a separate night.
Mm-hmm.
We have it where they come,
but I don't think I've
had meetings and the parent meetings are always on Tuesdays, and then the individual dens, because they're sizable, choose which night they're going to meet. And some of them do it on Tuesdays.
And that
so
works too.
I
give latitude to my den leaders, but it has to be at the den leader and the families that all agree.
Yeah,
we have our tigers on Monday, so that if we need a refresher before we have to do the skin of the pack meeting, we have an extra day.
Okay, so yeah, make sure you give that feedback. Ask your parents what motivates their boys. Your leadership, same thing. Get regular feedback from your leadership. Find out if there's motivation problems at the den level and how they're keeping their voice motivated at the den level. Okay, tools, we're almost done. Your leadership, great tool. Have a PAC point person if you can. For me, it's me, I'm the membership person. Have that person be the one who's responsible for following up with those scouts who are dropping off. And make sure it's somebody who's willing to pick up the phone and call and make that outreach to those scout families. And make sure that your den leaders are reporting to that person if they have somebody that's dropping off. Because if they don't let us know, Billy Cub Scout is gone and we have no way to get him back because we didn't know.
Poor Billy.
That sucks for him.
Because use your den leaders. They're the closest leaders to your scouts. They're going to know their families better than anybody else in your committee, on your leadership. And so they should start to be able to tell if there's an issue going on with the scout. And then if all else fails, get in touch with a district membership committee and they can help you out. Again, parents' feedback is a gift. Make sure that you get it and use it through parent meetings, annual planning. We actually invite our parents to annual planning too. And then ask your parents to help out and then recognize their efforts, because if they're involved, they're more likely to stick around. Recognition, make sure that your scouts are getting regular recognition, immediate recognition as much as you can. Our PAC meeting every month, we give them segments for whatever event we just had, rank, anything like that, we give it to them at that PAC meeting. And the same thing with your parents. Recognize your parents at some point. Recognize your leadership at some point so that they know, hey, we really value what you're doing, and if they feel valued, they'll stick around. Fun awards. We did like fun Pikeman Derby awards just to keep it fun and help spread out the award stuff for the boys. We give out, like we said, we get the books and the t-shirts when they join, because we find if we send them home with a handbook and it's 2 weeks till they come, they'll get excited by doing that. If you send them with nothing, they may lose interest. So motivating and maintaining membership go hand in hand. Motivated scouts equals maintain membership. There's your links. We talked about, so the Brand Center, that's, you can get all of your buddy cards. There's tons of great information there. There's tons of great printables there. You can find the scout video there. Be a scout.
Scouting Wire is another good one. The 11 Moms Project, if you want to know how moms think about Cub Scouts, go there. It's a project that was done in Washington State, and they went around and they talked with 11 moms. They filled 11 moms giving their story of how great Cub Scouts is and what Cub Scouts did for their son. It's fantastic. And then the Tufts University, there's a PDF if you want to hand out something, or the videos also. Okay, so that's what we went through. We have like 3 minutes.
Good job.
Final thoughts, questions? Yeah.
Have you had a situation where you have run into leadership in a unit that is inadvertently talking to people else? Give some advice. I have a community chair who I watched tell a little boy she couldn't promise him that they were ever going to camp. Mm. And everyone from her parent meeting or everyone from her recruitment night went home without signing up, even though the boys had a great time. It's just, her life's hard, and she talks a lot about the time commitments.
Yeah.
Well, why is she doing Cub Scouts? Because that the program is to go camping.
Well, I was going
to
say,
she's
saying that camping is part of the program anyway, and that
she's had a lot in her life this last year, and she has trouble getting away from the negative things, but short of keeping her out of the unit and only keeping the tiger I'm not sure
I would see if you can you find someone who's willing to take over being like the camping planning person, have somebody plan your camp so that then she can't say you're not going to go camping. She has someone that puts it together.
She talks like that when she talks to people. They say, when do we
come to Baby Powell
moment?
My cousin have a sit down and have a come to Baby Powell.
It's not come to Jesus, it's come to Baby Powell.
Yeah, if she's negative, she needs to find that motivation.
She needs to find a new job.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks.
Take care, Beth.